Hello, my name is Kim Roten. I am an attorney in Kingsport, Tennessee, and I am here on behalf of one of my clients that owns a... floating house. We are for reasonable regulation on the floating houses. My client's floating house is licensed, permitted. He purchased it in March of 2015, which apparently was after the study began being done. We would have liked to have known that at the time, because maybe he wouldn't have purchased it. He made a investment of over $130,000 in this floating home. He actually owns the real estate under the floating home, as well as the real estate, about half an acre onto the land. He hired me at that time that he purchased this to make sure that he was in compliance, make sure that it was in compliance with TVA's regulations before he purchased it. I did that. And here we are, it may be taken away from him because of people who are not permitted abusing the system, if for lack of a better word. So instead of option B2, we're here to request that any of the other options be picked by this board. Specifically, alternative C or B1 are fine with my client. Obviously, people who are not getting permits should not be allowed to have floating houses or non-navigable houseboats on any reservoir that TVA has. But those that have followed the rules, and those are the same rules from 1978, I think they were amended again in 2003, but since 1978, no new houseboats are supposed to have been put on these reservoirs, yet they're there. And if I'm not mistaken, there's over 900 that are not permitted. So that brings me to the question of enforcement. The enforcement on at least the lake, because I also live on Boone Lake, I own my own home there. And so the enforcement on our lake is pretty stringent. So I'm not really sure how these non-navigable houseboats and floating houses have been allowed to come without being permitted in the first place. So I guess after reading this entire study that was done, and yes, I did read the whole thing, but after reading it, the environmental impacts aren't specified in detail. The safety aspects are only the safety aspects of the ones that appear to not be permitted. But that's the one thing missing from this entire study, is there's no delineation between the permitted ones versus and the licensed ones by TVA versus the non-permitted ones that I can tell. So what are the statistics on that? Are the permitted ones, obviously they've been permitted, so they're probably safe. They're probably environmentally friendly if TVA has permitted and licensed them. So my issue with this entire proposal of just putting a sunset and getting rid of all of them in the next 30 years is simply, A, it's a taking. I think that's obvious.
Ms. Roten, could you wrap up your comment, please? Thanks.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. And B, we just simply need to enforce it better. And that's the one thing in this study that I just didn't see addressed, is why we haven't enforced it since 1978. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for allowing me to speak. My name is Jody Music, and I'm from Kingsport, Tennessee. My wife and I bought a permitted houseboat in the amount of $130,000 on Boone Reservoir. I'm in support of option C, in which permitted houseboats are allowed to stay, and I'm even in support of increased regulation and fees to help manage those permitted houseboats. I would like to speak to Mr. Jim Hopkins' statement where he said the TVA is worried about the environment and the safety impacts of floating houses. I've read the TVA's recommendation in its entirety, and nowhere is it documented that the houseboats have negatively impacted the environment, and I'm not aware of anyone who has been injured from these houseboats. The one thing that does stand out in this report is the TVA has allowed 918 individuals to build floating homes on the reservoir without permits. I ask that you vote for option C, where permitted houseboats are allowed to remain on the reservoir and those that are not permitted be removed. I'm even in support of increased regulations on the current permitted houseboats to ensure safety for the reservoir and individuals. Also, please consider the financial impact of those of us who have purchased permitted houseboats by the TVA. As you may or may not know, these permitted structures are very expensive. The high cost is mostly because you do not issue them anymore. Those individuals who cannot acquire permits or cannot afford the costs went outside the TVA and built non-permitted floating houseboats. My houseboat is permitted and is anchored to land that I own, and the electric is overhead. During low pool, my home sits on a cradle and all the wastewater is contained, and we're currently replacing the floats with encapsulated foam. My houseboat currently poses no threat to the environment or individuals and has no greater threat than any other house or any other boat dock on any other reservoir. Please manage the problem where it lies. Take care of those unpermitted houseboats and marinas that have not followed your guidelines and fix the problem where it lies. Do not affect those individuals who have TVA permitted houseboats that follow your guidelines. I am a small business owner, and I understand it takes money to manage any piece of your business, so I offer a solution. Create an annual fee of, say, $100. That $100 times 918 is $91,800. Let's say you pay someone $40,000 to manage this. That leaves you $50,000 a year towards management and even removal of houseboats that do not meet your guidelines. I would be willing to bet that most permitted houseboat owners would be willing to do this to make sure that all permitted houseboats are safe for the reservoir and for everyone involved. In closing, please do not sunset those of us who have followed your guidelines and consider option C. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mark Sullivan, and I'm a board member of the Tennessee Valley Floating Homes Alliance. My wife Heidi and I own a floating house currently moored inside of a marina on Norris Lake. Unlike some of the others you might hear today, we are relatively new to the area, having purchased our floating house in 2013 and subsequently relocating from Tennessee to Wisconsin. When we bought our floating house, we had no concerns that the TVA would decide to put that investment at risk. We had a mortgage from a local bank in Tennessee, La Follette. They didn't have any concerns. No one that we talked to or we had contact with during the purchase of our house mentioned any concerns at all. Not the sellers, the banks, more than one bank, the attorneys, the brokers, the marina owners, the inspector, the insurance company, nobody. We had every reasonable reliance that our investment was safe and sound. Floating houses are a culture on the waterways managed now by the TVA. This is not a new phenomenon. They've existed longer than the TVA itself and were unregulated until the TVA developed rules in 1971 and 78. With a moderate level of due diligence, the TVA could have easily prevented any further construction, but through lax management and oversight, more were built. If no further floating houses was TVA policy, you sure couldn't tell it by their actions. They obviously knew this was going on, yet declined to enforce the rules. They had continual presence on the water while those were being built and did nothing. Had the TVA personnel that worked with and met with the marine owners not given the green light for construction in their harbors, my floating house and many others like it wouldn't have even been built. In conversation and in practice, all systems were go and no issues were raised. In the construction industry, when a builder doesn't get a proper permit, a red tag is attached to the front door and all work stops until the issues are resolved. The TVA could have easily taken this approach and no further construction would have happened, but they declined. Many people have made good faith decisions to invest substantial amounts of money based on the factors I just mentioned. My wife and I made a decision to the tune of over $200,000. This is a huge amount of money for us. I mean, it's our retirement. Others that I've talked to have modest investments, $10,000. That's a huge amount of money to them. One of them even commented just in the last few weeks, I guess the TVA only wants the rich to enjoy the lake. The TVA estimates the current market value of the floating houses to be in excess of $100 million. That's $100 million of financial loss for owners that had a reasonable reliance that their money was safe. Unbelievable and unacceptable. I do see a need for standards. Everyone wants derelict, unsafe, or polluting houses to be addressed. Let's pass B1 and get working toward reasonable standards. The Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance is willing to be a partner in this. In the end, the one I prefer is, I recall, is B1 plus. B1 plus, everything is the same as option B1, but houses not brought up to standards or those abandoned are offered to nonprofit or other groups to rehab and provide increased lake access to the general public and low-income citizens. This is the win-win we're after. The TVA and the public gain nothing from destroying these homes. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for having us here today. My name is Randy Johnson, and I'm also a floating homeowner on Norris Lake. Private use of public waterways. This is the response that we continue to hear over and over and over again. Okay. As a floating home owner, my home is moored inside the harbor limits of a marina. We bought our floating home last fall to the tune, again, as Mark said, over $200,000. Before I made that purchase, I made a phone call because I have heard of the situation going on. Found out that a fellow by the name of Woody Farrell was a project manager overseeing this project. So I put a call into Woody. I said, explain my situation. I had a factory houseboat. I was fine. But I talked to Woody and I said, I need some guidance before we make this purchase. Where's the board going with this? And he came right out to me and said, we are going to be proposing B1. That made me feel very secure, okay, because that meant there was not going to be a sunset and there were going to be regulations and things were going to be the way they should be. Okay, so being in the harbor, I felt very safe. But when you think about it, I had a chance to talk to some folks last night about TVA's opinion of private use of public waterway. Where is this coming from? Well, there seems to be some miscommunication between TVA and maybe even the marina owners. There's been a lot of marina owners that have allowed so many floating homes to come into their harbors that you can't even get into the harbor. I drove around to some marinas and looked at this. I said, okay, I can understand that. Maybe some of these need to be removed or dispersed, or maybe perhaps the marina harbor limits be expanded to allow for them to stay. But in the long run or the short run, getting rid of these homes isn't going to help anybody in any way, shape, or form. It all is going to do is hurt us all. So what we need to do is look at B1. B1 takes care of the problem through attrition. If these homes are not up to code, if they're not taking care of their waste, they have to go. And they're through the permitting process and the fee, there are going to be people that will not pay. They'll be gone. There'll be people that will not bring their homes up. They'll be gone. 30% of the homes will probably leave the harbors just through natural attrition. That'll allow the ones that are outside perhaps the marina harbor limits to be brought back in and take care of the navigational issues as well as the waterway issues for private use. We don't privately own any part of the waterway. We know that. We pay rent to the tune of $3,000 a year for our home to sit where it sits. We paid that to the marina harbor owner. And he again pays fees to TVA and passes that along. So in closing, I thank you for listening to me today, and I hope you remember B1. B1 is happy for everyone. Thank you.
Good morning, TVA Board. Thank you, Chairman Rich and Board, for being willing to hear our comments this morning. My name is Eric Sneed. I'm a member of the Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance Board. My wife and I also started Fontana Families for Floating Houses over in North Carolina. So we are residents of North Carolina. We are owners of actually two permitted pre-78 non-navigable houseboats that are on Fontana Lake. We started a key effort in the effort to preserve these homes through an I petition. And so many of you received this I petition a couple of weeks ago. Very pleased today to say that we are well over 3,600 signatures on that petition with over 900 comments. That was double what was delivered to you back in April. And in a very short 1 month, 5 day period, that's a pretty impressive turnout, I think, for people in support of these floating houses. We estimate that nearly two-thirds of the folks on that petition are, in fact, not floating homeowners. And so there's a huge spectrum, a cross spectrum, if you will, of people, all walks of life out there that support these homeowners from all over the United States. We've got folks on there from California, Minnesota, New Jersey, Florida, as well as, of course, all of the different states that are affected in the TVA service region. There are hundreds of comments there as well from non-floating homeowners, and those are good comments, meaningful comments. My wife, you'll hear from her in a moment, she's tweeted dozens of them out over social media. And so, you know, we feel like that, again, there's a good representation there of folks that not only own these houses, but folks that enjoy these homes. Recreation is obviously a prime piece of what TVA tries to advocate on the lakes. Fontana Lake is a unique condition. It's a very remote lake. And within your studies, I think that it's even reported that over half the users, 54%, I think, of the user days on lakes like Fontana are in fact from the floating homeowners. So one point that, you know, we think needs to be made very clear is that by removing these homes and removing these people from the lakes, you're deeply impacting the folks who actually use those lakes for recreation. Finally, I wanted to talk a little bit about my background. I'm an enrolled member of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians from Cherokee, North Carolina. This week, there was a resolution passed by the Eastern Band, my tribe, basically in support of B1. The EBCI has been a strong partner with TVA over the years as a steward. It's a key federally recognized tribe within your service region. There are at least 20 tribal members who own non-navigable houseboats on Fontana Lake, and there are hundreds that use those houseboats and enjoy them. I would encourage you to take into account, again, all the stakeholders out there, the folks that are the good stewards of the environment, folks like the tribe, and folks like these floating house owners who can help TVA manage these. We support Alternative B1. We hope that you will join us in that fight. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Laura Sneed, and I co-founded Fontana Families for Floating Houses, and also I'm a member of the TVAFA, whatever. Anyways, I'm here today because we started a petition, and as of this morning, as he said, we had 3,632 signatures and 935 comments. We are floating homeowners of two pre-1978 houses. Our house, one of them, is probably from the 50s. And we purchased it from a family that their real home actually burned down, and insurance wasn't able to cover all their costs. And so they were able to sell this as an asset. Where we are in Swain County, North Carolina, is a majorly economically depressed area. A lot of the people that own these homes, I mean, they're basically fishing shacks, a lot of them there. You know, work hard, they work paycheck to paycheck, and to take this away from them and to take this asset from them is really tragic. We're one of the more fortunate people. We own two homes. We've got two adult children and two babies. All are enrolled members of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians. And the reason why we support B1 is because these people, the North Carolina houses as well as the TVA houses, are our neighbors in our community, and it'll affect the marinas and it'll affect the tax base. Swain County is a huge county, but it's mostly, it's federal lands, it's the lake, it's also the reservation. We actually live on the reservation. So, I mean, they're not able to get taxes from any of those. So they actually tax the house boats. And we pay our taxes, we pump. I wouldn't let my two-year-old swim in the water if it wasn't safe. We just ask that you consider B1 for all the families. If this was the right solution, we wouldn't have a petition that's, you know, 3,000 plus names. We're on track for 4,000. I know that in the EIS, they listed a petition of 5 names, and I think it got up to 20 before it closed. That was, I believe, against us. You know, if this was the right solution, you wouldn't get emails and letters from congressmen like Mark Meadows in North Carolina, as well as yesterday, 7 congressmen and women, Diane Black, Marsha Blackburn, Stephen Fincher, sorry, Chuck Fleischman, John Duncan, Scott DeJars, and Phil Rose, as well as the counties passing resolutions, Swain County, Haywood County, Graham County in North Carolina. Graham County is even on the lake, as well as in Tennessee, Campbell, Anderson, Claiborne, and Washington, and of course the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians, who passed the resolution in support of B1. If this was the right solution, all these people wouldn't be coming together. You're hurting North Carolina. You're hurting communities in Tennessee. Please, please consider B1. Please, please do the right thing. I mean, we can be partners. We don't have to be losers. I think we definitely need regulations, but I think we can all be winners, TVA, as well as the homeowners, because we did the right thing, and we're asking you guys to do the right thing. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Lauren Weaver, and I want to address the public use, private use for public lands. TVA leases square feet to or acreage to the marinas described as harbor. Harbors occupy about 0.7 or 4,159 acres of the entire 636,892 TVA reservoir acreage. TVA licenses or leases designated square footage to marinas operators design the space for commercial marinas. 98% of floating houses are generally located in the commercial marinas. Floating houses, houseboats, and other small boats lease space from within the marina, usually defined by an annual lease. This lease includes termination clauses, mostly common within 15-day notice. The lease could be for a mooring spot, slip in the marina. The location leased can be changed by the marina owner or the customer. There are no rights or continuations at any one spot. The customer is simply paying for square footage in the marina harbor. As far as square footage leased by the floating house, houseboat, or other watercraft, it's publicly available, and marina owners will always rent additional space to the public as they are interested in attracting more customers to increase revenue. Marinas provided public access to general public. They provide launch facilities, parking, gas, food, ice, snacks, and drinks, as well as boat storage as a place to stay on houseboats, floating houses, and surrounding cabins. There is no place to stay the public would have to leave at the end of the day. One other factor to consider is public access. If the sunset provision is adopted, there will be seven marinas on the TVA that will suffer and even go bankrupt. Have fewer marinas will affect public access negligibly. Therefore, marinas, houseboats, and floating homes provide access to public waters. So we ask that you would do B1 to be able to stay on the lakes. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sue Weaver. Our family has a love for Norris Lake, enjoying it for better than 12 years now. It all started with a neighborhood trip of seven families who rented two houses on land. The next trip, we rented a floating house. From there, one of the families bought a floating home. They invited our family often, wanting to share the lake life experience with family and friends. We also purchased a floating home. Our float house is located in Flat Hollow Marina in Speedwell, Tennessee. We purchased the home for our family getaway vacation spot. We contribute to the local economy with purchases from the marinas, gas stations in town, as well as grocery stores, restaurants, insurance companies, and hardware stores. We are just one family out of the 900 plus families with float houses, making a large impact on the local economy and job placement for many of the local residents and college students. I pulled three statements from the Economic Policy Institute covering the TVA resources to provide electric. Two, the economic development is integral to the TVA's mission. Three, river and land management. The floating homes do not interfere with these resources that the EPI talks about. The future economic impact to the region and float house owners is financial loss to those who have invested in good faith. We are asking you to reconsider B2. Sure, there are other places we could go, but we chose Norris Lake because of the charm, beautiful surroundings, and the local people. If we have the homes at our expense removed in 20 years, this is just adding insult to injury, not to mention the huge financial blow. The floating homes are full of good people who care about our surroundings and leave the area better than we found it. I would like to invite all of you to come and see for yourselves what we hold so near and dear to our hearts and the life experiences that we would like to continue with our family, friends, and neighbors. We sincerely hope that you will rethink the sunset rule, moving from the B2 to a B1 option, allowing existing floating homes within permitted marina harbor limits. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Carmen McGee, and I'm a member of the Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance and a floating home permitted B4 floating home owner on Norris Lake. I'd like to thank you all for the opportunity to have this discussion today. Today, I would like to paint a picture of what sunsetting floating homes looks like in the real world. There's a young family with small children. They purchase a floating home. They go every weekend, they make friends, and they love it. They enjoy it with family and friends for years to come, but the kids are now involved in travel ball and other activities, and they're spending less and less time on the lake, so they sell it. That same floating home is purchased by an empty nester couple. The kids are away at college, but they come home to visit their parents on the floating home for a fun and relaxation, and of course, bring lots of friends. They enjoy it with family and friends for a few years, but one of them gets a job transfer to a different state, so they sell it. Then that floating home is purchased by a retired couple. They have grown children and grandkids that love to visit them on their floating home. It's where their grandkids learn to swim and dive and tube and ski. They enjoy it with family and friends for a few years, but sadly, one of them passes away, so they sell it. Since becoming a floating home owner, I have personally witnessed all of these scenarios. Although some people have their floating homes passed down from generation to generation, and some have plans to keep them and their families for years to come, the majority are bought and sold every few years for reasons, all kinds of reasons, lack of time, relocation, illness, financial, just to name a few. Sunsetting our floating homes immediately devalues them and renders them virtually impossible to sell. And that leaves the current homeowner holding the bag for continued maintenance, mooring fees, yearly fees to TVA, and then a $7,000 to $10,000 bill to destroy it. Now, we understand that there's work to be done. We, too, would like to see floating homes be brought up to code and maintained. But what happens when someone can't afford those new fees or to bring their floating home up to code? They certainly can't afford the $7,000 to $10,000 to remove it, and now they can't sell it either. So what does that picture look like, and who's left holding that bag? People come to our lakes because of floating homes. Why would you want to remove something that makes us unique? Why not work with us to improve the problem areas so that we can continue this heritage for future generations? The Tennessee Floating Home Alliance respectfully asks TVA to partner with us to keep this legacy of floating homes and to make it something we can all be proud of. Please consider option B2. Thank you. Oh, sorry, B1, not B2.
Good morning, Mr. Johnson, Chairman Rich, Board of the TVA. Thank you for your time. I'm Mike Wilkes, President of the Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance. Safer, better, cheaper, faster. These words have resonated into everything that we've done over the past 8 weeks. How can we partner with the TVA in addressing environmental concerns? Safer. We applaud the TVA for finally, after years of complacency, recognizing that there are some issues out there. While there have been no documented cases of electrical shock drownings and floating homes, precautions should be taken. Unlike the clear implications in recent TVA releases and communications, we are the public. We demand safety from our neighbors, and we would anticipate the TVA addressing those issues. Better. Who better to partner with in stewardship than the users? We use the water every day to drink, cook, and bathe. We have a vested interest to keep the waters clean. So let's partner with each other to provide for analysis, reporting, and enforcement. Let's look at the root cause of the problem and not take the opinion to be hell-bent on making the ends as you see fit. The new TVA has an opportunity to collaborate on a solution. Cheaper. Volunteers with a passion, as you've all seen over the last few days, have proven to donate time to their cause. The TVA has an historic opportunity to partner with the TVFHA to develop and execute a long-term, manageable, and sustainable program. Faster. At the speed of the internet, we have been able to mobilize a force faster than any governmental agency. We have enlisted the cooperation of local, state, and federal bodies and experts in various fields to provide a fair and balanced approach to this issue. Let's take a reasonable time, combine forces and independent labs to establish baselines that truly monitor water quality. Being wise by being attentive.
You have a great decision to make today. Be attentive to the fact that there is still much study and work yet to be done. Be attentive to the feedback given by those who are the true stakeholders. Be wise. Adopt option B1. Recommend that the staff work with the stakeholders to develop this long-term, manageable, and sustainable partnership, or table this for further review. Thank you very much for your time and consideration, and hopefully you all have learned a little bit more about floating homes over the emails and phone calls and letters that you all have received. Thank you again.
Good morning. My name is Marianne Lefker, and thank you for the opportunity to address the board today. I realize as I stand here that you guys have been bombarded with opinions and insights and concerns on an issue that all of us in our wildest dreams didn't think that we'd be looking at. As the TVA has been openly permitting by way of discretion to not enforce 26A, the addition of the floating houses to the reservoirs with documented counts over time can't be a surprise. My husband and I invested in this recreational opportunity in good faith. We want to be good stewards of the beautiful reservoir. We want to have a safe and well-maintained floating house, and we're more than willing to abide by all the rules. We just need to know what those rules are. They need to be clear and defined and enforced. As I'm sure you've read the almost 500-page report, I'm confident you have found there are some inconsistencies. I did, and I know that the document is flawed, but it's also a process. It's the beginning process to address some of the concerns while taking some responsibility for the current environment. I know that much of the new information that has been gathered since that report was published has been an eye-opener to not only the floating homeowners, but to the reservoir area businesses, local governments, county governments, and state governments as well. Please keep in mind that it took 2 years for this report to be put together, and in only a few weeks since those postcards showed up in our mailboxes, we've been able to give you some good information on some impacts that reach far beyond that TVA report. Under the TVA Act, the TVA's stated objectives included working closely with other public agencies and private entities. With resolutions and legislations from local, county, and state governments opposing the B2 proposal, it would appear that that objective has fallen well short of the TVA's stated purpose of collaboration when decisions are being made that would directly affect their interest. I would also ask that you note that comments from the TVA Floating House Policy Review, some agencies were asked, and the Southern Environmental Law Center was one, the Tennessee Department of Environmental Conservation was one, Virginia Department of Environmental Quality, and the Virginia Department of Historic Resource. They're all listed in there as having been asked opinions. Contrary, each one of those indicated they could support B1. They also said they could support B2, but they did say they could support B1 as an acceptable alternative with appropriate regulations and enforcement in the future. The future is what I'm struggling with. With no documented water quality issues, no navigation issues, as 98% of the floating houses are anchored on leased space by the public within the Marina Harbor, with no known restriction of public access to the reservoirs by floating houses, and a thriving economy throughout the TVA region where millions of documented dollars are being spent.
Thank you.
When Rebecca Tolley responded to Tennessee Congressman Duncan's inquiry.
Could you wrap up, please?
Yes,
thank
please.
You.
With the 20-year sunset period, our investment went to zero. Thank you.
So I'll remind our speakers that when the light turns red, your time is up.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. My name is Gary Farwick, and I'm the owner of Flat Hollow Marina on Norris Lake. TVA, through its FEIS policy report and many public meetings, has introduced many sensible issues relating to floating houses. We, the public, would like to facilitate or compromise and meet with the majority of those requests to TVA, the address TVA concerns. However, in doing so, we ask this morning that TVA Board rejects B2 alternative in favor of B1 alternative. This B1 alternative gives TVA everything that they want except the sunset provision. We accept the freezing of growth of the floating houses and the development of any reasonable standards that would improve safety, environmental, and water quality. All floating houses owners and their children and guests swim and recreate in the waters of the floating houses and the marina harbors where they are located. Invoking the sunset provision is too severe of an economic impact on the regional economy, the individual floating house owner, and the marinas. The FEIS did not address the impact on tourism, grocery stores, convenience markets, gas stations, restaurants, churches, etc. In Campbell County alone, $54 million is in tourism revenue. The lake is the only asset in Campbell County, tourism asset. The FEIS study estimates that the value of 1,836 floating houses is $101 million, and the additional $18 million will be lost in tearing down those floating houses, a significant amount of money for the floating house owners to absorb. Excuse me. Marine owners that have over 60% of floating houses in their marina versus factory houseboats will likely face bankruptcy due to the loss of mooring rent and slip rent of the floating house customers. Others will be severely impacted. In support of the request to implement B1 versus B2, we have concerned government bodies, as you well know, that have communicated to the board, as well as 3,000 interested parties in favor of the B1 through the I petition. We therefore request the board to vote to accept B1 alternative today. We also have a number of things inside of the study that we object to or that are misleading, but I don't know if I have much time to do that. Floating houses are not designated and used for habitation. They are used.
Mr. Forward, could you wrap up, please?
Thank you. That's it. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Kathy Rollo, and my family owns a 1972 floating home on North Lake. As you've heard, 98% of the floating houses are located within marina harbors, and I want to make sure that you understand that that means that they are pumped by, Blackwater is pumped by the marina or by a contractor. I've spent the majority of my career managing environmental characterization projects for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the U.S. Department of Energy. So I would like to address the environmental concerns. The environmental impact statement you are basing this decision on only speaks to potential water quality issues and clearly states that there could only be minimal, minor, or little ecological benefits to even the most stringent alternative B2. For every single environmental resource listed, it doesn't contain any data to support that floating homes are harmful to the environment. The study states that most of the contaminants of concern for the reservoirs in the TVA system cannot be related to domestic wastewater and that TVA cannot attribute data trends to marine activities. According to the environmental impact statement, 60% of the reservoirs in the TVA system that received poor ecological ratings do not have a floating home on them, not a single one. The state of Tennessee 2015 water quality standard for total fecal chloroform level was a mean of 200 colonies per 100 milliliters of water. Fecal chloroform is a subgroup of total chloroform. So we've got total chloroform, fecal chloroform, all right? The U.S. Department of Health says that even if you have total bacterial chloroform is detected in drinking water, the source is probably environmental and probably contains no fecal chloroform. Again, the Tennessee standard is 200 down here at the subgroup. In 2015, the mean for total chloroform colonies in the fall utility water plant intake on North Lake was 92 colonies per 100 milliliters. So you've got 92 at the subgroup, and I'm sorry, the subgroup standard is 200, and we were at 92 at the parent group. So to say that is contaminated is like putting 92 hundredths of a lemon into a swimming pool and saying you've made lemonade. Similarly, Swan County Health Department, North Carolina, performed extensive water quality tests on Fontana Lake, concluding that floating homes were not contributing factors to contamination levels. According to the Virginia Department of Environmental Quality fact sheet for impaired waters of 2014, excess contaminants in South Holston is directly related to farming and in no way associated with floating homes. Again, there's not any way to directly correlate any contamination in the TVA system to floating homes. It is abundantly clear that no reasonable person could justify sunsetting floating homes based on environmental concerns. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Tice McGee. I'm with the Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance as well, one of the board members and vice presidents. I wanted to talk to you today about the private use of public waters. The reason being is that when I looked at the EIS statement, I couldn't find anything in there about private use of public waters. It was kind of a new talking point that just kind of came out of nowhere. So we just heard from Kathy there about the environmental piece, and you've heard also about safety. We can't find the connection at all. So this private use of public waters, let's talk through it real quick. So floating homes have been moored in marinas for the last 50 years. Okay? Each month, these floating homes are leasing space from the marina operators on a yearly basis. We pay thousands of dollars per year. We're using these floating homes on weekends, long weekends, etc. 6 months out of the year, typically. Marina operators lease this harbor space from TVA, and in turn, they collect the fees from the floating homes. And those fees then go back to TVA. They also use thousands of dollars that they receive from us to improve the marina operations as well. And it benefits not just us, but the other boat owners as well. On Norris Lake alone, there's 34,000 acres. You've probably heard this before, but when I look at your data, floating homes in all the marinas make up less than 1%. 99% of the lake is open waters. If you consider all TVA lakes in the reservoir, marinas represent 0.7% of total water usage. It's dramatic. And 98% of the floating homes are moored within the marinas, again, in the harbors. We're not in the navigational areas. Floating homes invite many others to the lake due to their pure enjoyment and somewhat ease of access from boater lane. Many drive hours, 3 to 6 hours, from all over the state, over the southeast to get there for weekends and holidays. Floating homes are moored in many cases beside other factory-built houseboats, some that move, never move, and cannot move. Those that can move and don't, are you forcing them to move out? I've got two neighbors, factory houseboats. I'm gone, they get to stay. Floating homes are routinely moved from space to space in the marina due to various reasons. No one has legal right to a space. Floating homes can also be moved outside of marina harbors. Floating homes typically are one story and sleep 4 to 8. Many are one step above camping on an island. Not what TVA portrays as floating subdivisions with 2,000 square foot homes and taking up massive amounts of water. Floating homes are routinely rented to the general public as well. So in closing, the TVFHA wants to partner with TVA and form a new alliance for everyone to benefit. Whom better to work with than the public that uses the lakes the most? We agree on the fact that non-regulation and lack of enforcement is not the way to move forward. We would request that the board reconsider, go from B2 to B1. Let's continue the discussions and let's move forward. We all want the same thing.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Debbie Samples. I am here as a board member of the Tennessee Valley Floating Home Alliance, but I'm also an owner of a marina. I own Indian River Marina on Norris Lake, been there for 21 years. It's hard to stand in front of you today and chat with you about this issue simply because I have a 30-day revocable lease. So I hope you believe in freedom of speech just like I do. I'm going to share with you a short story that I told the RRSC on April the 26th. A few years back, an actuary friend and myself had an appointment with a joint client. And in that meeting, the client brought out this elaborate study of what he thought his balance sheet liability should be. And when we left the meeting, my actuary friend said to me, "Oh, Debbie, how do we tell this guy that his baby is ugly?" I'm here to say that your baby is ugly, your study. And please take that in jest. I do believe your EIS is flawed, and I'm going to share with you two reasons. As I said, I own Indian River Marina, and I moor 23 floating houses, and I own two floating houses. If those are forced to go off of our lakes, I will lose $55,200 in annual income. Some of those floating homeowners also have boat slips. I will lose $16,200 from those boat slips. So not only has my cash flow taken a huge hit, my marina is now devalued because sale price is based upon net operating income. So in that example, my marina value goes down by over $700,000. Another reason I believe the EIS is flawed is because your own people, George Humphreys is one of those, told me and my partners when we built floating homes in our harbor that it was okay with TVA. He told us that. He said that TVA was considering allowing marinas to do what they wanted to do within their harbor. So your own people have told us it's okay to build floating homes. And I've built six. In closing, I want to ask you to partner with the Tennessee Valley Floating Homes Alliance, and let's come up with some solutions. I urge you to adopt B1, alternative B1. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen of the board, my name is Barry Burgess. I'm the managing partner of McNabb, Gorgas, and Burgess Attorneys with offices in Memphis and Nashville. I asked myself, what could I say to a group of people that wanted to destroy my home in 3 minutes? Luckily, some of the speakers that preceded me have covered much of the territory that I wanted to cover. I do want to mention, it's my understanding that the Tennessee legislature has now passed a joint resolution, and I understand there was no opposition to it on either side of the aisle, rejecting the sunset provision, or urging that you reject the sunset provision. I don't know if you've seen the resolution or not. I would commend that to your consideration. I fully agree that the EIS that was prepared in this case is severely flawed. I filed a 10-page comment. I would commend that to your reading. I dissect that document with some intensity. Can't cover that in 3 minutes. Instead, I want to talk about the Cherokee community where I own a floating home. It's on Ricketts Creek on the Kentucky Reservoir, approximately mile marker 126. The Cherokee community is fundamentally different from other floating homes that are located in marinas because, number one, it's been there. That community started about 50 years ago. My father-in-law was one of the first residents of the Cherokee community. It's a series of boathouses where boats are stored and approximately 8 floating houses that have been there for decades. They were some of the first floating houses there as far as my understanding goes. They've been there for decades without incident. No collision, no sickness, no electrocutions, nothing. The major difference is that the owners of the floating homes also own the land where those floating homes are attached. So if you require the destruction of these floating homes, you're actually depriving the owners of the use and benefit and enjoyment of the property that they own. TVA only has an easement for water flow at that location. It's important to note that TVA makes absolutely no distinction and take the position that they can take the property. And as an attorney, I'm going to take the position that that is a governmental taking that would have to be compensated. So you're looking at litigation if that occurs. It's fundamentally different because the water quality on Kentucky Reservoir is acknowledged by TVA to be good. There's no problem with the density. Like I say, there's only 8 homes at that location. It's also different because those 8 homes are homes to...
Mr. Burgess, could you wrap up, please?
Are homes to a group of permanent residents that live on fixed income and would be simply devastated if they were required to leave those homes. They do not have the means to upgrade or anything else. They will, in essence, be made homeless. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Mark Godsey. I'm a law professor at the University of Cincinnati, and I'm a floating home owner in Shanghai Marina at Norris Lake. And I want to address the request that we have that you reject B2 and adopt B1 instead. And I want to just tell you my story as somebody who bought a floating home in good faith. I'm not someone who was sneaking around saying, I'm aware of these regulations, but I'm going to take advantage of the fact that TVA is not enforcing them, and I'm going to build a home anyway. I bought an existing home, and what I saw when I went down there and first vacationed at Norris Lake was a very thriving market. People enjoying the lake, buying and selling these floating homes. It was open and notorious. There were no signs posted anywhere saying that these are at risk. I fell in love with the lake. I decided to buy my home. And this was a substantial investment for me. I had money that I had saved my entire life that was just sitting in a bank account. And I'm one of those people, I intend to keep it the rest of my life, but I'm in a situation financially where if I need to sell it, I need to get that money back at some time. And that money was sitting in a bank account doing nothing. And I said, you know what? I can buy a floating home. I can enjoy that money in the meantime with my family. But if something comes up, if I need it later to pay for my kids' college, I can sell it because there's a thriving market. But I don't invest stupidly. I looked around and I saw that this was a safe investment. I saw that the house I was buying did not have numbers on it like some of the other houses. So I asked around what that had to do with, and I ended up calling TVA, just like Randy Johnson testified about earlier. I know that you are not the folks that answer the phone when people call TVA, but you have to understand what people in our position were told, many of us. I said, I'm considering buying a floating home, and I noticed mine doesn't have numbers on the side. Is that anything to worry about? I was told that has to do something with happened back in 1978, but it's not being enforced. We're leaving it to the local governments. The only issue that might relate to you is because you don't have a number and a permit, you might be taxed by your local county on an annual basis at some future year, so pay attention to that. And I thought, oh, okay, a couple hundred dollars in taxes, property taxes a year, no big deal. That's it. That's all I have to worry about. That's all you have to worry about. So I bought the home. Now, a couple years later, I hear that there's this report going around and they're considering B1 and B2 and all this kind of thing. And I think, if they're going to sunset these, I need to sell this while the market's hot. So I call up again. And I say, is this something I need to worry about? And I was told, just like Randy Johnson, we're going to be putting forward B1. And I said, so I don't need to worry about a sunset. And the reaction, I'll never forget these words, I got a chuckle. And the person said, if they ever recommended sunset, I sure as hell wouldn't want to be at that meeting. Okay? And I went back and told that to other people in the marina. I invested my money, which is my life savings, in good faith, and I was careful, and I was a purchaser in good faith. I don't think anybody intentionally misled us. I think something went awry at some point. I can't explain why. But I think one of the theories is that when they had these meetings a couple of years ago to talk about these proposals, you didn't have the floating homeowners show up in droves and the marina owners.
Mr. Gottsick.
Yeah.
Mr. Ashball's next, so could you...
Okay, and I'm just going to say the reason that happened is because we had been told this wasn't a realistic possibility. Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you for letting us speak today. My name is Tom Ashpaw. I have a floating home on Norris Lake. Been coming to the lake for about 25 years, started in a fishing boat, and then a runabout to a cruiser to finally my dream, a floating house. My kids, my family, my kids, my grandkids, and many friends have enjoyed weekends with us at our floating house. We're inside the marina. There's no navigation restrictions that I can see. We take pride in our homes in the marina, and we take pride in the environment. Some of the goals I've seen in the postings about the TVA provide economic development for the Tennessee Valley. We support the marinas, the restaurants, the local economy. I'm always running into town to the hardware store, to the grocery, for something that I've forgotten. So we spend money there. I've hired local contractors to work on my house. Another one of the goals, protecting public lands, waterways, takes partnerships and public engagement. We are the public, and I promise you we are engaged. No one knows floating homes like we do. We would love to partner with you, as many of them have mentioned. Having an alliance partner with the TVA would benefit all parties involved. Another TVA to support the recreation that is enjoyed by millions of people. We enjoy our recreation. I love to fish and boat with my family. Fourth of July, we have a Fourth of July boat parade. We all enjoy that. I pay the marina for my mooring. I rent 2 boat slips. I pay for my boat registration in Tennessee. I pay LaFollette Utilities for my electric. And I contribute thousands of dollars to the local economy. Our lakes are for everyone, not just a few. Wow, 1,800 floating homes are not just a few. Water quality, sewage, electric, I see no problems there. If there are, we'll fix them. My kids and my grandkids and myself, we swim at our floating house. I wouldn't be swimming there if there's any danger. Consider a partnership with us so we can work together to improve these conditions. Don't throw out the 98% of us responsible owners for the 2% who are not. One thing that also I learned was 49 dams have an engraved message, built for the people of the United States. I'm 69 years old. I'm a veteran. I've served my country for 4 years in the past. I've worked all my life to be able to buy and give my family the pleasure of weekends at my house. Thank you very much. I appreciate you listening to us.
Good morning, Board. My name's David Crisp, and I own and run Crisp Boat Dock on Fontana Lake in western North Carolina. I've been there since 1956. My family has. That was handed down from my father, and I'd like to hand it on down to my children. But I'm here to represent the boathouse owners that is in my harbor. I've got 80 boathouse owners. They all got septic systems as pumped. They're all in accordance with TVA law. They don't get out of the harbor. They represent, and they pay their taxes. They help all the businesses around. They spend money, and I just want to come down here and ask you to go with Resolution B. Thank you.
Good morning, Board. My name's Gary Henson, and I own a floating non-navigable houseboat at Perryville Marina, which is in Decatur County here in West Tennessee. I'd like to quote first Mr. James Adam, as I heard him say many times, that we're already connected at the hip. We just got to figure out how to get along now, and that's what I'd like to see happen. I purchased my non-navigable houseboat in 2009. Before doing so, I did a careful review, including calling TVA. I was given a lot of information by TVA. I was told that my particular boat that I was buying was previously permitted prior to 1978, and it was grandfathered in. I was even referred to Section 26A, which says non-navigable houseboats approved by TVA prior to February the 15th, 1978 shall be deemed existing houseboats and remain on TVA reservoirs provided they remain in compliance with the rules. Mine was in compliance with the rules. I filled out all the proper paperwork to do the transfer of ownership, and I sent my fee in. It took them a long time, and I had to put a lot of pressure on them, but they finally approved mine. So in 2010, December of 2010, and I've made sure each one of you have a copy of this, I have a permit approval saying it's okay to have my house there. Had I known that there would be a 20-year sunset rule at any point, I never would have invested into that house. To talk about the public use of it, the difference in building a tree house in a national forest and me having a floating house is I have a permit to do it, and they're not issuing any permits for tree houses. You talk about the public use. There's lots of privately owned marinas on the water. Those are privately owned marinas. If I want to open a marina, I can't do it because those are permitted marinas that have a permit through TVA to operate that marina, and they're not issuing any more of those that I know of. There's boat docks and boat piers that are all up and down the river, and some of them are in the main channel, and those obstruct the navigational right-of-way way more than mine does because mine's not on the main channel. We have been somewhat misled at these public hearing meetings in that we were told the TVA was leaning strongly toward B1. At every meeting we were at, don't worry about it, we're leaning strongly toward B1. And then we were shocked to get a postcard to say there was a 20-year sunset proposal. So I'm encouraging you to vote strongly for B1. We're connected at the hip. We want to work with you. We want to make this work. We care about the water. We use the water. We fish. We recreation in it, ski. And thank you very much for your time today.
Hello, my name is Kim Hall. I'm from South Holston Lake, East Tennessee. Earlier this week, I was told that this was really a very simple issue. These people built homes on land they do not own. I can assure you, and respectfully you've seen today, this is far from a simple issue. The TVA and Ms. Tolene have been quoted saying floating homes have been prohibited since 1978. However, your own policies have allowed them as long as we followed regulations. A recent post on the website, a new post, says we're grandfathered. And although it gives no end date, in a legal connotation, that grandfather clause without a date tends to lead us to believe it's in perpetuity. The majority of our homes are moored in marinas where we pay a slip rent fee. Other than the physical property, we've made no claim of permanent property ownership. We are there at the pleasure of the marina who pays you rent. You claim to want to give this land back to the public. However, if our properties are removed, the marinas will simply add more slips to compensate for their lost revenue. It's a fallacy to believe that the public gets used to the land back. And if our properties sitting in marinas are truly navigation risk, how are the many private docks located in the main channels not? You cannot ignore the financial impact across all states involved, from slip rent fees, mortgages, incremental spending, sales tax revenue, insurance premiums, etc. There's a significant financial impact. Was that even considered? TVA has sanctioned these properties for years. Permits have been issued, expansions have been granted. Until now, these numbers only appreciated in value. How can you eliminate $100 million in property values like that? And it's not our financial loss only. The sunset proposition will cause a financial ripple across all taxpayers. How will you cover that? There have been no water quality impacts that can be tied directly to floating homes, any more than other vessels on the lakes. We're probably the most conscientious users of the lakes. My children swim in that water. Cleanliness and safety is of a priority to me. The Travel Channel has a program called Extreme Houseboats. It's really interesting. You should watch it. There's some amazing homes out there. It's enlightening how other states have made this work. Oregon, Washington, Florida, to name a few. Canada, even. Why is it that these areas have figured out how to make this work and yet we can't? Have you given consideration to the removal of these properties? TVA's not adequately managed the expansion of their existence. How do you think you're going to manage the removal? The taxpayers will end up being the ones that bear that burden. I recognize and realize some of these properties are in violation. Some have not been properly maintained. As a leader in a large global bank, we learned long ago, you can't punish the majority for the sins of a few. Address the ones that are issues. From a personal standpoint, words can't do it justice. Until you've stayed in one of these homes, sit on the front deck, you won't get it. You're welcome to come to my property anytime. It's an experience you must have. And sadly, as my daughters look to me and say, why would TVA do this, Mom? I honestly have no valid answer for them. Your excuses, your explanations don't hold water. Thank you for your time. Please, let's figure this out together.
Good morning, Mr. Johnson and board members. My name is Ryan Garlitz. I'm a floating house owner. Several years ago, my family and I visited Norris Lake for a family vacation, and we rented a floating house. After several years of vacationing at Norris Lake and renting various floating homes, in March of 2013, we purchased a floating house. We had been boating and spending vacations at other lakes in Kentucky, Indiana, and Ohio for over 20 years. But the reason we chose Norris Lake and over all the other lakes were the floating homes. Now, as the owner of a floating house, we frequent the lake with family and friends. We also rent our floating house to the public. Last year, 86 different people, not including my family, used our floating house as a place to stay while visiting the lake. Many of our renters tell us the main reason they also choose to vacation at Norris Lake are the floating houses, which offer a unique and cost-effective opportunity to stay on the lake. I am here today to ask you to please consider alternative B1 instead of alternative B2 with a 20-year sunset period. Removing floating houses from the TVA lakes, including Norris Lake, will have a negative impact on the communities that surround the lakes. Removing floating houses from the will have a negative impact on the marinas that rely on mooring and other fees that are paid by floating house owners. Removing floating houses will have a negative impact on the floating house owners that purchased these vacation properties without prior notice that the structure would ultimately be worthless and have to be destroyed. Consider the economic impact to Norris Lake. There are currently 921 floating homes on Norris Lake. With a 20-year sunset, there will be 921 fewer places to stay, which means fewer people will be able to visit and enjoy the lake each week. Fewer people will be purchasing gas and groceries or stopping at a local restaurant on their way to or from the lake. Fewer contractors and handymen will be needed for repairs. Fewer people will hire local fishing guides. 921 fewer boaters will be paying mooring fees to marinas, paying for pump outs, buying gas and supplies, renting a slip, and eating at the marina restaurants. Fewer rentals mean the state of Tennessee and other local counties will receive less revenue from sales and hotel taxes. All of these items translate into the loss of jobs that will have a negative impact on the local economies. The impact to the marinas would be so significant that many will go out of business, meaning even less areas for the public to stay, rent a slip, or purchase gas and supplies. 86 different people stayed in my floating house in 2015. I believe there are at least 50 floating houses being rented on Norris Lake. If each floating house that is rented brought 80 visitors to the lake, that is 4,000 different visitors in 1 year. If each of the not-for-rent floating houses had 8 visitors, that would bring 7,000 more visitors. Removing the floating houses from Norris Lake could eliminate access to approximately 11,000 people a year. Please eliminate the sunset period and not the floating houses.
TVA board members, my name is Tom Kloppert.
I'm a floating house owner within the marina at Flat Hollow Marina on Norris Lake. My family and I have spent many hours on a number of lakes in this region, including Cumberland, Dale Hollow, Kentucky Lake, and Fontana Lake, to name a few. We chose Norris Lake because it seemed to be more suitable for all the activities we enjoyed, along with the accommodations. We have been spending long weekends and weeks of vacation for the last 30 years on Norris Lake. At first, we would spend time at a condo owned by my son-in-law. My son-in-law and I have spoke many times about building a floating house, which would be more convenient for all of us. After several years of discussion, and both my parents passing on, there was a small inheritance that I received. After some thought and investigation by my wife and I decided this floating house would be a wise investment versus stocks, CDs, or savings bonds. So along with my son-in-law and my daughter, we had a floating house constructed as a retirement investment and a getaway from the stress of work. When our house was built, we secured all the necessary building permits and had all inspections performed at each stage of construction, including electrical inspections. Therefore, in 2003, we built our floating house and have been spending many hours and weeks at Flat Hollow Marina on our floating house. We have developed many relationships with other homeowners and members of the neighboring communities. We have also spent a substantial amount of money in the surrounding areas along with religious organizations. The thought of the B2 proposal with the sunset ruling would be devastating to me, financially and personally. This does not include the marinas and the nearby communities. We have always been conscious and have honored all environmental standards to maintain the integrity of the lake. In closing, I beg you not to consider the B2 option with a sunset ruling. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
Billy Mincer, Joe Stewart, Pandy English, Don Henson, Jeffrey Watts.
Good morning, Board. My name is Patty Eberharder, and I own a floating home at Powell Valley Resort. I'm not a public speaker, but what I am is a mother. I'm Nana. I'm a Christian, and I'm a mentor, and I'm a citizen. Today I come, not because I want to get up here and talk, but I'm going to be a voice today for those that couldn't be here, and that's my grandchildren. I want to be their voice, and I'm today going to talk about a little 10-year-old boy, and his name is Aiden. He's my grandson, and the reason I'm so emotional is that he asked me the other day, he loves that floating home. He said, Nana, why are they taking our home from us? I couldn't answer it because I don't understand it either. Let me tell you about Aiden. I sit on the porch in the morning and I drink my coffee, and Aiden's in his little pond hopper. And you know what he's doing with his friend? They're picking up garbage in the marina. That's what he does. He is a voice. He needs to have a voice in this. Today also I speak for my friend Polly. Polly succumbed to cancer 2 years ago, and she was my neighbor out there. She loved that floating home, and when they told her she had cancer, she didn't cry because she had cancer. She cried because the doctor told her she could no longer be on the floating home because of safety issues. She has a voice today, and I am that voice for her. This is our children's legacy. This is my retirement. This is what I give to them. I have 3 grandchildren and 1 unborn, and today I talk for them. They are good stewards of this lake, and I beg you not to take this away from them. There's a better option. We can all work together. We need to pull together and do the right thing. This is not just all about us. This is about our future, and we need to do the right thing today. I appreciate your time. I'm sorry for the emotion, but I am real about this. I'm a real person, and I appreciate you hearing my voice today for my grandchildren and Miss Polly. Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Wilson, I couldn't understand her name. What?
Eberharder. Patricia Eberharder.
Okay.
My name is Jim. Patty's my wife. We have the beautiful floating home. Pleasure of having that at Powell Valley Marina. In 2008, concerned with, like many others have stated here before us, wanting to do the right thing, I checked around and called around to different various offices and was directed to the boating commission, the boating division, and spoke with a real polite gentleman, Keith Nash, who told me that the same thing, that the floating homes were going to be an issue for the marinas if they had room for them in the harbor, that they were allowing them to build them as long as you did the cooperate with the state and local codes, building codes, electrical codes, encapsulated flotation, holding tanks, and that nature, that they were aware of them, and at this time, or at that time, were not opposed to the building of them. So we proceeded, and so here we are today. We would greatly appreciate you really considering the B1 so that we can pass our home down to our grandchildren. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Billy Mintzer from Maryville, Tennessee. More than 60 years ago, I used to go to North Lake with our family and enjoy the waters of that beautiful lake. You know, TVA took, and I spent an entire career at the University of Tennessee teaching conservation of natural resources. TVA took 1.3 million acres from private citizens for its reservoir system, using the power of eminent domain for the public good. And when they did that, all the land and lakes became property of the people of the United States. And TVA promised the people, through its mission statement, to manage the reservoirs not only for flood control, power, and navigation, but also for recreation and natural resources. But starting in the late 60s, and these weren't there when I was on the lake, there was nothing but beautiful water and beautiful forested ridges. Floating houses started creeping onto the lakes. Owners of these houses, good people, obviously here you can see, were in effect kind of like squatters on public property, poachers of a public resource where most owned no property and paid no taxes on that resource. To prostitute the lakes for private use and private profits at the expense of the rest of us is wrong, and in the process, spoil the beauty of the lake. You know, we've been bombarded by opinions of folks, from people like me and the floating house owners, and emails. But you're hearing from a vested interest of people that have something to gain or lose on that property. And I don't think you're hearing from the rest of the public, the other 300 million people that own the TVA lake system. I think TVA should have done a public opinion survey, a scientific survey across the region, if not the nation, to see what the rest of us think, to guide you in making this decision. You know, the board had a similar crisis to make a decision on back in 2006, the sale of lakeshore property for residential housing. And following more than 5,000 public responses to that issue, 96% of the public was opposed to sale of lakeshore property for residential use, and the board, with a 9-1 vote, banned further sales of those properties. Now you have the same issue, privatization of public property, this time on the surface of the lake instead of up on the lake shore. Now, these TVA lakes are a national treasure, almost like a national recreation area available to some 300 million Americans. And each of you as board members are the gatekeeper of that national treasure, and it's up to you to protect it for future generations. Decide on behalf of all the people, not the privileged few.
Mr. Mintzer, could you wrap up, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm done, but I'm for a total ban, but with total consideration for these floating house owners to recover their investment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning. I'm Pandy English. I work with the Environmental Services Division of the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency. I appreciate the opportunity to express our opinion on the floating house issue. TWRA is a participating partner agency in TVA's program to manage floating houses. TWRA fully supports TVA's program to manage floating houses, and TWRA supports the preferred alternative. TWRA specifically supports the requirement that floating houses meet strict standards for mooring, electrical connections, potable water supply, sewage and wastewater disposal, and fire code compliance. TWRA supports requiring that all floating houses be within the boundary limits of approved marinas. TWRA supports the removal of all non-compliant floating houses from TVA reservoirs. TWRA will continue to work with TVA to prevent floating houses from being fraudulently registered as boats or vessels. Floating houses should pay taxes and fees sufficient to fully fund TVA's floating house program and to compensate the county equivalent to lakefront property assessments. At present, floating house owners put these structures on public property with the expectation that they have appropriated public property for their exclusive private use in perpetuity. It is essential that TVA and the TVA Board of Directors take those actions appropriate to protect public property for public use. Thank you for this opportunity, and our opinion is in writing.
I'm Dean Watts. I'm from Knoxville, Tennessee. What else can you say? I mean, these people voiced their opinion, and I'm thankful that you guys and ladies are very attentive and watching. I'm a people watcher, as my wife would say, and everybody's been attentive, and I appreciate that because we are concerned. I'm not, my father-in-law, you're going to hear from him in a moment. I ran into him 9 years ago while dating his daughter. He takes me out on the lake for the first time. He says, you want to go see my houseboat? I know what houseboat was. I fished for years, my father, on lakes in East Tennessee, and are grateful for them, and was taught to take care of them. I go back, I was telling the lady back there, I got switched because you done the right thing. And that's what these people are doing. They're doing the right thing. They're here, they're standing for it. And we want to do the right thing on the waters. But anyhow, going back to the story of my father-in-law, I walk out, we were riding out on a boat. I did a wake flaw. I made a wake. He jumped on me. No wake in this harbor. Okay, second time I did it again. He let me know. There are certain rules that we apply by on the lake as houseboat owners. But when I saw that houseboat, I thought I was in hog heaven. I thought, great, I'm gonna marry this girl. Well, I did, and I enjoy it every weekend. It's our great place that we get away. I have children, his grandchildren go to it, and he wants to pass it along to us. And we have taken upon ourselves to fix it up what we're supposed to do, and do the right thing, as I was taught as a child. You do the right thing. And for these homeowners out on the lake, do the right thing. They want to enjoy their lives just like you do, just like I do. I want to pass it along to my son, my stepdaughter, my daughters, whomever. We want to carry this legacy on. And with your support and your help, we'll stand with you. We'll do the right thing. We will make these homes safe. And if there is one out there that's bad, hey, like my grandmother said, I'm not going to whip y'all for one that's doing wrong. It's a true statement. Most of the houseboat owners take care of their stuff. For example, I'll go out on the lake, your lake, the board that you, your TVA, that you stand by, these lakes are taken care of. I'm not boasting or bragging, but I've seen many, many people out there on that lake taking care of them trees that's floating down through there. they'll push them off the bank. See styrofoam, take it off the lake. We help too. And these people need to be recognized and appreciated for that. So with that being said, thank you for listening to me. Hope I didn't bore you. And I'm glad I got a little laugh out of you out here, but please just work with us and we'll work with you. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to us today, Mr. Chairman, board members, and Mr. Johnson. We appreciate your concern for the TV. I'm sorry, my name is Joe Stewart, and I have a floating home in the Flat Hollow Marina. We appreciate your concern for the TVA waterways and the same waterways that we love and respect and use. I won't belabor many of the same points that have been made in the interest of everyone's time here, and I won't take the full 3 minutes. I just wanted to bring up a couple points that our floating home has been used for to provide access to elderly and disabled that houseboats simply don't, navigable houseboats simply don't provide that same access to those folks. And you'd be closing out, sunset clause would be closing access to those people and waterways in the waterways use to those people upon sunset that would make them accessible to all. Houses have many steps, and some of the navigable houseboats have very narrow passageways that are not accessible. Upon a sunset ruling would also bring about years of litigation will surely follow, with all the negative press on both sides. In the essence of saving tons of time and valuable resources and millions of dollars, I implore you to pass Regulation B1, which makes sense for all concerned. Thank you for your time and your service.
Donna Driscoll, Rick Driscoll, Gary Parson, Deborah Prince, E.L. Morton.
My name is Dawn Henson. My husband and I purchased a non-navigable houseboat in 2009. We closed on that property. We had our permit properly transferred to our name, and we thought that was final. Last year, we attended a meeting held by TVA in regards to the future of the non-navigable houseboats, and we were told that if ours was approved before 1978, it was grandfathered in. We do have one of those, and we have paid our property taxes, rent, and marina, and rent to the marina for 7 years now, and we are now told that TVA is proposing that all non-navigable houseboats will have to be removed in 20 years. How is this fair? If you get a permit for something and you're willing to comply with whatever is asked of you, how could you be made to remove your house? There are people that have spent a great deal of money to have a place on the water. And I know there are lots of these non-navigable houseboats that are not in compliance. But why can't those people be punished for their wrongdoing and be made to comply? Not everyone should be punished because of a few wrongdoings of a few people. My family has enjoyed our house. We have celebrated many birthdays, graduations, anniversaries, and holidays here. It is a very special place to us and our three children. And I ask that you please consider how to handle this without making the people properly permitted to remove their houses, the places that they love so much. And I ask you to please consider B1. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board, thank you for your time today. My name is Donna Driscoll. By its own admission, the TVA has been negligent as it has selectively enforced 26A regulations. For over 38 years, the TVA did nothing and was well aware of the population of floating homes on its reservoirs, as documented by their own reports published in 1997, 2006, and 2011. Many floating homeowners directly contacted the TVA, as you've heard, and were told by their representatives that the construction or purchase of a floating home was not an issue, that they were leaving the matter to local government. Marina owners were told additional floating homes could be built as long as they were contained within the harbors. As a result, a vibrant economic market segment was born based on floating homes. Hundreds of hardworking American citizens invested significant amounts, sometimes their life savings or a significant part of their retirement assets, in floating homes based on the assurances of the TVA. It fails the common sense test to think that you would invest this kind of money in an investment asset with a zero rate of return. So I'm prudent. I'm careful with my money. I save. I scrimp. I'm saving so I can buy a floating home. I'm assured by everyone I talk to, the banks, the marina owners, the insurance companies, and the TVA, that it's okay. There's not a problem with this purchase. Make sure you're in a marina harbor. Make sure you're compliant. You're good to go. I'm really assured because the TVA, the ruler of the reservoir, has told me this. So I take the plunge and I spend thousands of dollars. And now 38 years later, you tell me, sorry, changed your minds? The TVA has never, until now, provided reasonable public notice to potential floating home purchasers that their investment was subject to forfeiture and condemnation. This is an unprecedented legal action, analogous to an eminent domain action in a violation of the Fifth Amendment. Option B1 provides exactly the same standards, oversight, and regulations as B2 without a sunset provision. And as noted, it is also the option supported by numerous counties, the state of Tennessee, and the Eastern Band of the Cherokee. So I ask you, what's more important, that you stay the course and vote on an option that has been shown to be based on a flawed philosophy and skewed facts and is also economically devastating? Or do you make the factually supported and unbiased decision to confidently support option B1? Thank you for your time.
Good afternoon at this point, I think it is. I'm not sure, but I'm Rick Driscoll. Thanks for listening to us. I just wanted to let you know, I, as one of the owners, I called the TVA before I built, or had it built, I should say had it built. It took like four times to get a hold of them in about a month. And I was told the same thing. I was told they were washing their hands of it and leaving it to the county government. I never would have built if it wasn't allowed. This was in 2004, 2005. So it's been a while ago, but I was told they were washing their hands of it and leaving it to the county governments. I asked about the numbers. They said they weren't even doing anything with the numbers anymore. So I don't want to take any more time, but I did want you to know that we all try to do the right thing and are still trying to do the right thing. So thank you.
My name is Debbie Prince. My husband and I have owned and operated Prince Boat Dock for 20 years. We've always taken pride in our marina and Fontana Lake. We were eager to get on board when Swain and Graham counties adopted the waste recovery septic system. We always have yearly lake cleanups and get our customers involved, and we've been awarded the clean marina by TVA. Our customers pay Graham County over $30,000 in tax revenue yearly. We support many local businesses, which includes gas and propane companies, sewage disposal, bait and tackle shops, boat dealerships, ice companies, battery distributors, drink companies, building supplies, local convenience stores, and restaurants. 85% of our customers drive 60 miles or more, spending money with local grocery stores and businesses. They also take their families rafting, zip lining, hiking, biking, and other activities. As far as water quality, one of our customers spent his own money to have an EPA certified water analysis done. Our water is very good to great to pristine. I have a copy of that report I'm going to leave for you today. We also have a petition with houseboat owners and local businesses that will be affected. Our counties have the highest unemployment rate in the state. We cannot afford to put more people out of work. Has TVA considered the impact on the environment when the people abandon these houses in 20 years? Houseboat owners can't afford to pay $7,000 to $10,000 to remove them. What would they do with them? I've talked a lot about the economic impact, but this will also affect families that have invested their retirement money to provide a safe place for their families, a place to hand down for generations. We celebrated Father's Day, Mother's Day, birthdays for 19 years with our parents, memories that's going to last us a lifetime. Our customers are hardworking, middle-class Americans that the majority could not afford to purchase a piece of property, $200,000, and then put a $200,000 or $300,000 home on, even if the land was available on Fontana, which it isn't. I attended meetings in 1978 where TVA was going to implement new regulations. If these regulations had been enforced, we probably wouldn't be here today. I sincerely ask that you remove the sunset clause and lake uses fees and consider the people's lives you're affecting before making your decision. Thank you.
Morning. I'm Gary Parson from Knoxville, Tennessee, also known as the Harbor Master at some of the boat docks I've been at, keep Dean straight. I purchased a houseboat in 1982. At the time, it was not registered. I worked hand in hand with the office out of Morristown, made all corrections that needed to be done to the houseboat, got the registration, the certification, and moved on from there, not expecting anything like this. But as TVA issued mandates that we had to meet, we did it. We put on holding tanks. We maintained the houseboats, worked with the dock owners, you know, if they made a request, we did it. And we have tried to do the right thing and keep the waters and our environmental impact at a minimum. I feel like that we're somewhat being singled out. There are other boats on the lake. There are factory-built houseboats on the lake that have the same systems that these floating homes have. They have other gasoline, oil, bilges that they pump out. We don't have that. We have no hazard involved in that. So I really feel like that we're being singled out, and I don't know where the target came from, but we ended up being it. I asked you to give us some consideration, and let's go with B1. Thank you.
Kevin Kep, Charlene Hogue, Mark Chandler, Bradley Hodge, Tony Sherrill, Max Shieldstone.
Chairman Rich, Mr. Johnson, board members, I'm E.L. Morton, Campbell County Mayor. I've spoken with you on a few occasions in the recent past. I'm happy to report to you that the A&S Steel Building has sold, and we expect 40 jobs there with an initial investment of about $16 million. It's going to expand to 50, and we're going to expand to 200 jobs on that site. I talked to you about 18 months about that, about 18 months ago. We have to build a substation. We're fortunate to have an EDA grant opportunity there to build it out, but we're backing into this because it's German money that came to us and bought that building. So no application yet through the state approved, but it's in process. So it's a blessing to be able to back into it. We celebrate $16 million worth of investment in our county, an ARC distressed county, a state of Tennessee distressed county. I celebrate every day $25 million worth of marinas on Norris Lake that you've helped put there over time. We're your largest marina population county in TVA. I've got 11 of them. Debbie told you that she's going to lose $700,000 a year. Okay, my $25 million business tax base just became a $16 million business tax base. That's going to be $300 to every household property taxpayer in Campbell County. You're hearing a lot from Cincinnati, Ohio. If you didn't inherit the farm 60 years ago, you went north. We learned how to say you guys instead of y'all, but we got that relationship. Outside money has been coming into my community because of that relationship. We're seeking that outside money in to grow our tax base. We haven't fully recovered. We're the top of Tennessee on I-75, and I'm looking forward to being one of those counties that works with you to announce those jobs. But in the meantime, I can't turn my back on $8 or $10 million worth of tax base out there that keeps my other folks in the county at a reasonable cost of living. We've got several things to celebrate, but I come to you as an elected official. Norris Dam and Norris Lake is your highest concentration of this situation. I understand that. But you have heard from folks. It's a statewide situation that you're addressing. I'm working with Commissioner Templeton on a 90-day rural economic development task force that Governor Haslam has commissioned. These assets, these marina assets, the 180 marina assets across Tennessee alone are powerful economic drivers. And so I ask you not to sunset the homes on Norris Lake for sure and across the state of Tennessee. But I think it's an opportunity for us to grow rural economy in a responsible way. We're for clean water, safety, and all those things. We want to work with you, but I've got nothing to work with if you sunset these homes. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Charlene Hogue. I'm from Swain County, North Carolina, and I represent the Freedom and Land Rights Coalition, which is a nonprofit organization of approximately 2,500 members, primarily in Western North Carolina. Part of our mission is to advocate for public use and recreation and government-owned lands and lakes, and we oppose any action by the TVA to remove floating homes or houseboats from TVA lakes. The creation of Fontana Dam in Western North Carolina and the reservoir is a dark spot in the history of TVA. Fontana Dam was authorized by Congress as a TVA war project to provide hydroelectricity for East Tennessee and the manufacturing of war munitions. Land was acquired by eminent domain, and the TVA paid the lowest price in TVA history for an inhabited area for land it took in Swain and Graham counties. Currently in Swain County, federal land holdings is about 87%, and in Graham County, it's about 84%. So we have very little tax base. TVA took over 68,000 acres from an 11,000 acre reservoir and transferred the excess acreage to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. As you've heard before, these two counties are the poorest in the state because of this. Now to add insult to injury, you're coming after the houseboats and the marinas. These are assets, taxable assets to Swain and Graham County. They do not pollute Fontana Lake. In 2005, there's an ordinance and state law passed which mandated pumping and treatment of wastewater from our houseboats. And $738,000 was invested in this effort, including a $90,000 grant from TVA. So our water is clean, and so perhaps instead of mandating a blanket policy, you need to look at each reservoir on a case-by-case basis. The new proposed policy by the TVA is just another example of the federal government taking from Swain and Graham counties without compensation. More government regulation always equals fewer freedoms for Americans. As the U.S. Constitution guarantees that property shall not be taken without compensation, and that the houseboats on the TVA reservoirs are property, I just wonder, have you established any kind of compensation plan if you are going to take these houseboats and property? In Western North Carolina, our county governing commissions have passed resolutions against your policy, your proposed policies of removing houseboats, and TVA should respect the governing bodies in these communities. Thank you.
Thank you for letting me speak to y'all today. if I had talked to Ms. Hogue before I wrote this out, because she pretty much done all my presentation. My name is Tony Sherrill. I own and operate the Alarka Boat Dock on Fontana Lake, and I'm also the president of Fontana Lake Waste Recovery. It's a group of dock owners that provide a service for all our houseboats. We do all our sewage pump outs and so on and so forth. And well, the only thing I can go to is to the B2 option. The B2 option, it's pretty much with our 60-foot drawdown on Fontana Lake, it, you know, the houseboats is pretty much most of our business. If we don't have the houseboats, then our marinas will pretty much shut down. So after 40 years, I was kind of hoping to kind of leave the business to my kids, maybe my grandkids. But if you go through with a B2, then, you know, that'll probably be an end. So anyway, I appreciate y'all letting me speak, and I wish you would look at the B1 option, and we would work with you. I mean, after 40 years, we've been doing a lot of work anyway. So, and I appreciate y'all.
Connie Burnett, Don Safer, Terry Jones, John Calvert, William Hillary, Rick Nunley.
Good morning, board. My name is Kevin Kapp, and I'm from Columbus, Ohio. I drove about 7 hours to make it to this meeting this morning. I'm here to speak to you about the floating home as well. I am an owner at Flat Hollow Marina. My home is within the harbor, and I spent probably the last 30 years or so coming to different lakes, and I have such an appreciation for what the TVA has established. I've been to Dale Hollow, to Cumberland, to several. Probably 10 years ago, I came across Norris, and when I first started visiting Norris, because I wanted a place at the lake, I wanted a second home, and I looked at options for on land, and then I came across floating homes. I stayed a couple times. I said, wow, you know, I can pull up to my home with my boat. I can use it. I don't have all the maintenance. I didn't want a houseboat. I didn't want all the maintenance. I don't want to have to go tie it up. I don't want to have to do all the other things that come with that. So again, like others, I made an investment. I took a huge portion of my retirement, and I could have went to the bank, but I said, nope, it's an investment. I will rent it out to get some of my return to do the reduction. I'm not, you know, paying my rental. But I will pay the fees. I will cover everything. I want it to be maintained. I try to maintain it to the top notch. I will work with the TVA to maintain this. So I question today for you guys to consider, what problem are we really trying to solve? Because the same structures, whether it's a dock, whether it is a vessel, you have sewage, you have electric, you have all these other considerations, okay? I built this home with no consideration that I would lose my $200,000 investment, okay? That is going to have a substantial impact to me and my family. So I would also challenge, as I've heard about, you know, green energy and the things that the TVA stands for, sustainable living, that has been made possible all over the world, why we can't look at it here. What other options could you take to marry some of these ideas, you know, whether it be solar or other ways to facilitate this, instead of just taking a hard look to say, we need to remove these in 20 years? Because I pose the challenge, what's it going to look like in 15 years when I know that my asset is, you know, needing maintenance? What am I going to do to say, well, do I want to invest money, you know, only to turn around and have to pay to have it removed? So again, I think, like the other home owners here,
your time's up,
consider
please.
B1.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Johnson, Mr. Chairman, board members, still good morning by about 10 minutes. Thank you for this opportunity. My name is William V. Hillary. I go by my middle name, Van, and I'm representing the floating homeowners. Let me just say before I say anything else, I would like to echo what one of the other speakers said. I have been watching y'all very intently back there, and you all have actually been paying attention. You've either mastered the art of pretending to pay attention when your mind wanders, or you're doing it, and I presume that you're doing it, and we appreciate it, because you all have really been taking notes and everything else. Sir? Which part? Yeah, I believe so. I mean, it appears you're doing it anyway. So you have or have had or will have, each of you, copies of resolutions passed by eight counties in East Tennessee and Western North Carolina. You've got a resolution that has been referred to earlier from the state of Tennessee passed unanimously. You've got a resolution from the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians, and you've got eight signed letters or eight signatures from members of Congress, and they all say basically the same thing. Would you please not adopt alternative B2, consider it B1, and or would you postpone your decision while we think about this a little bit more? And it's not, they have not made those statements or taken those actions because they think the way things are now is right. They don't think that. Nobody thinks that. Nobody here thinks that. It's that they think that alternative B2, and I think surely it is kind of a given at this point, the devastating financial effects that alternative B2 will in fact have, not only on the floating homeowners, the marina owners, local governments, their school systems, even banks that are hung out because now their collateral is not quite what it was when they made a loan on a floating home. I think all that should be obvious now. And so what these folks are trying to say is that it's not that we don't think things ought to change. You said there ought to be some regulations that haven't been enforced and so on. But this is such an overreach with all that devastating financial effect. And I say it's an overreach. Y'all got a job to do. But what kind of makes it an overreach is not only the devastating financial effect, but there are other alternatives that appear to us to solve the problem, so-called alternative B1. And you had one gentleman say, even if B1 doesn't solve it, we'd be willing to do B1 plus if there's some cats and dog issues out there that it didn't quite cover. And if so, that may take require a delay in that decision so we can all get together. But these issues are real, and we've had emotional pleas, we've had substantive pleas, we've had all kinds of pleas, and I hope that collectively that y'all were listening, and I know you know what power you have. You've almost got absolute power over these kinds of issues, and I know you know that brings with it a lot of responsibility, and I know you take that seriously. And I have to believe that some of this information you received today, maybe it's not some information you've had before, and that maybe that you will consider doing this. So I'm about to run out of time, but let me just say, we would really appreciate, you've got their attention. We used to say in Congress, if you grab them by their budgets, their hearts and minds will follow. You've grabbed them by their budgets.
Thank you, Hillary.
You got them.
Thank you.
Let's work collaboratively. They'll do anything that's reasonable to solve this problem as long as they don't lose the value of their homes. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the board. My name is Janet Benzinger, and my husband and I actually own two floating homes on Norris Lake in the Shanghai Marina within the harbor. We purchased our first floating home about 3 years ago, and we loved it so much that we decided to purchase a second home with the understanding that we would be able to sell our first floating home. But what I wanted to make sure that you understand now is that just the mere announcement of the fact that you're considering the B2 proposal has really rendered us helpless in trying to sell our first home. And again, this is a significant investment on our part. To some of you, this may seem like a small investment, $150,000, but whether it's $10,000 or $150,000, it is big to all of us. And again, I think that if you could just consider that as you think about some of the decisions you need to make. I wanted to say that, you know, we do respect and love Norris Lake. I mean, we wouldn't be there if we didn't. You've heard people talk about their children and grandchildren coming and making memories at the lake, allowing their children to swim in the lake. So again, you know, we're some of your bigger supporters in making sure that it's environmentally sound and safe, you know, for visitors to come. The sunset, we feel that the sunset provision is really a harsh punishment for the homeowners, when in fact we feel that the TVA has been negligent by not creating or enforcing reasonable regulations, allowing some of the homes to become very dilapidated. And you know, those of us who take care of our homes, we don't like that either. So you know, we really want to be able to try to partner with all of you to try to find some reasonable solutions. Again, you've heard a lot of facts and figures from a lot of different people today, and so I guess what I'd like to do is really to appeal to your hearts versus your heads today, and if you could strongly consider adopting the B1 proposal versus the B2. Thank you for your time.
Good morning. I've got good news for the board. There's only three more after me, okay? So I'll be brief. My name's David McClure. I had a nice speech. I really did. But these good people behind me have made almost every single point I wanted to make, except the lady who preceded me, and she made my last point, because I also own two of these in Parable, Tennessee, over in West Tennessee, on Kentucky Lake. I don't own two because I want to, right? I own two because, as of a year and a half ago, I couldn't sell the other one because of the proposal you got in front of us. So I have two of these. I enjoy both of them, but I really only want to enjoy one of them, okay? So the financial hardship that they're talking about, some of us are already experiencing. So since I'm doing really good on time and not making a lot of points, I want to go a little different direction, okay? In my career, right, I've been in management for a long time. Early on in my career, I was about a 30-year-old, and I was trying to get a proposal across, right, to my management team. This is what we should do, you know, and I was having a hard time. So I had meetings and stuff, right, and we'd have some feedback meetings, kind of like today. And I finally went to one of many mentors I've had, took a couple levels up and said, you know, this is what I want to do, you know, and he said, I said, what do you think? He says, well, is it legal? That's what you want to do, one, legally correct. I've done X that one off, yeah. Is it represent all the stakeholders, you know, employees, community, all stakeholders? And I said, you know, yeah, somewhat, yeah. And he says, you know, a couple things. If you're in power, you have power, okay? So I recognize your power, okay? And you guys have a legal team. You have a VP of legal, which is pretty big, okay? Now, you make it legal. Make sure you can be legal, right? But if you have to have a bunch of meetings and a bunch of discussions to figure out whether it's right and it's fair, then you may need to rethink it. Maybe your proposal, you know, right and fair, you usually recognize very quickly. You know, as experience, you get this, right? You see what's right and fair, and you go, I got that one, okay? Now, sometimes it's gray, but most times we want to make it be gray so we can justify what I want to do, right? Not what is fair and right. So that's all I'm asking you guys to do is, does it pass that test? Because we've had a lot of meetings on this, and that just concerns me. So support, I respect you, and if you can look out for us, I'd appreciate you, because these are awesome good people behind me back here, okay? They did a great job this morning too, so thank you.
Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jamie Brady, and I am from the southeast side of Columbus, Ohio. About 14 years ago, this month, my husband and I traveled south to Norris Lake along with 16 friends. We rented two houses. We spent a long weekend there, fell in love with the lake and the surroundings. 2 weeks later, my husband and I went back with family members and had rented a houseboat, which we took out of the marina, spent a week out on the lake, had a wonderful time, enjoyed ourselves immensely, and we looked at each other when we got home and we said, you know what? We've got to go back and we've got to do something about being here a little bit more on a permanent basis. Went back a couple more times, and by Labor Day that same year, we went down, we stayed at Flat Hollow again, which we had done in the past that year. And we went out, we got with a realtor, went out, looked around a property and all, and we're like, this is a little bit out of our price range, and it's a little bit more of upkeep than we care to take on at that time, since we would still be working and living out of the Columbus area. So we're sitting at the marina and we're talking with a couple of gentlemen there, and I said, tell me about these houses out here that are floating on this water. We did. An hour later, we are touring some of these homes out on the water. My husband and I went around the corner, said, what's the worst could happen? Well, coulda, woulda, shoulda. The only way we can afford it, of course, is to rent it. So we went back, talked with these gentlemen. Is there a possibility that if we did build this house, can it be rented? They said, sure, we can do this for you. So we jumped in. October 1st, we dropped our first float, and here we are 13 years later. Again, our house is a rental. So I don't consider our home to be a private residence. This year alone, come the second week of June, clear through the last third week of August, our house is totally rented, not one day open. Out of that, I looked it up, that is 11 weeks, so 11 families. Our home supposedly houses eight people. That is 88 persons that are going to, or 11 other families that are going to come to Tennessee to spend their money and to enjoy that lake. I'm just asking you to please consider B1 instead of B2. I hate to take that away from me. This is my retirement money that we invested. And I hate to take that away from the people that come down. And most of our renters are repeats. Year after year, they are making memories also. So I thank you for your time. And I come from Eastern Ohio, so it's not y'all, it's yins. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Glennis Broyles, and I'm also a houseboat owner. As you notice, I don't really have an accent. So I am from North Lake. One thing is, we are home floaters. To be one, you got to know one. So you know one now. And one other question I have to ask, are you using hydropower for these air conditioners? Because if it's coming from North Lake, we have no water at all. My little thing would be today, we're talking about floaters and navigable houseboats. You're willing to take off the non-navigable houseboats. And there was an issue about people staying year-round on navigable houseboats. They are on navigable houseboat, but non-navigable houseboat. There was an issue with electricity with navigable and non-navigable. Non-navigable is shore power. Navigable houseboats are usually steel or aluminum. This is a conductor. They have three sources of power on those boats. They have shore power, they have a battery inverter, which creates 120 volts electricity, and they also have a generator. So we're back on shore power. We look at the footprint. We're talking about a footprint of a navigable houseboat versus a floater. Most of the navigable houseboats have a larger footprint than the floaters do. The navigable houseboats are set up for navigable waters. They have Y valves in their systems to discharge gray water, black water, and all, and they still exist on these boats. The floating homes does not have that. They have all septic systems or holding tanks, which is pumped on a regular basis. In most cases, as everybody is telling you, we are the stewards of the water on the lakes. and my time is getting short. One thing I got to tell you that read recently is that the government regulations cost the average household $15,000 per year. Thank you very much.
My name is Mike Miller. I'm from Knoxville, Tennessee. And I know you're going to remember me because I'll be the first to wish you good afternoon instead of good morning. And it'll be the last floating home story you'll hear. We own a floating home at Norris Dam Marina. My wife and I have been boating on Norris for 25 years and dreaming of having a place on the lake. Always thinking being a land-based home, and it was out of our financial reach until we discovered floating homes. As we investigated this, my background, I've been in the financial services industry for 42 years, the last 32 as a business owner. A linchpin of the financial service industry is due diligence, so I was going to do my due diligence on floating homes and TVA. I obtained the name of a Mr. Harrell at TVA and his phone number. I called him. We spoke on more than one occasion. I told him what my plans were, and he said that there was nothing that should stand in my way. I know you've heard this story from others here before, but I'm doing my due diligence now. We then made the decision that we were going to build our home. I called TVA back and said, we were going to be our own general contractor. What do I have to do? Where can I build this? I was told for environmental reasons, I could not build it on the water. I would have to build it on the land and launch it. I followed those instructions. In 2014, our home, along with three other homes, moved from one marina to another. We were navigable for a while. Before we went to that marina, which is Norris Dam Marina, the marina owner operator there called TVA to get permission to put it within his boundaries and was given that permission. I tell this story only to say in a span of less than 4 years, I've reached out to TVA on three different occasions to get permission to do what I wanted to do and was given permission every time I turned around. I have to rely on what people tell me. Mr. Harrell's position, as he told me, was he was over recreation and water use for all the TVA reservoirs. I figured that's about as high as I was going to get on the food chain by picking up the phone. I relied on that. We are good citizens. We love our homes. We love our lake. We have a deep concern about this ultimate decision and the effect on our personal financial situations. Thank you for your time.
On behalf of the board, I'd like to thank you for your very cooperative and respectful participation today. Mr. Chair, that is our last speaker.
I'd like to repeat what he just said. Thank you for the respectful way which you've handled this. It's obviously a difficult subject. I don't think we've ever had this many people show up and do such an excellent job of conveying their issue to us. We do thank you for being here. Those that are here for other reasons, we're sorry we're having to take so long, but this is obviously an important subject because we still have a board meeting to conduct. So that it concludes our listening session. Give us a little bit longer break. Let's reconvene at 12:30.
Thank you, Joe. Good morning, everyone. I'm suffering the lingering effects of a virulent cold, so if I sniffle or cough a little, I'll beg your indulgence in advance. It is a great pleasure to be here at Paris Landing State Park. We've been here a couple of days. We've seen bald eagles flying around, turkeys, people catching big fish. Might stick around a few more days to engage in that myself. And we also, the staff of TVA, really appreciate, Mike, you and your wife's hospitality and the hospitality of the whole community and here at the state park. Really, it has been a wonderful, wonderful experience. And I can't think of a better place than being at a state park to get to the heart of the issue on floating houses, which really is who owns public resources. But we're going to come to that issue in a little bit. That was a teaser. So now to floating houses. Our work as stewards of the region's natural resources requires us to deal with challenging issues, how to manage the river safely, and use other resources to provide the greatest good for the public, and that's for all the people that we serve. That question is at the heart of the study we've been conducting for more than 2 years, with numerous public meetings on how to address privately owned floating houses on TVA reservoirs. So we've heard a lot about this morning. We know what these are. We began a policy review and public input process on floating houses after identifying more than 1,800 of these structures on 16 TVA reservoirs. This looks a lot like commercial development of entire private communities on public waters. It also has raised some safety and environmental concerns, and as stewards of the river, we have to make sure we take care of those. Like national and state parks, which prohibit private residential use of public resources, the land and water we managed are owned by the public. One of the speakers mentioned this morning a resolution passed by the Tennessee General Assembly. I got a copy of that and thought maybe I'd look up what the law in Tennessee is. And so if you tried to put a floating house or build a structure on state-owned water or lands, it's against the law in Tennessee, as it is in North Carolina, and I would suspect every other state. We do agree that some individuals' activities should not affect other people's use of the region's natural resources. It was clear this morning that there are strong views on all sides of this. Had a lot of input today. I want to repeat Joe's comment about how well that was done and how politely and civilly, which is a good thing. But you know, there is some other views. That these should be removed or certainly remediated. We've had input from our Regional Resource Stewardship Council, which advises us on our resource management and our stewardship activities. They represent stakeholders across the region, and the council encouraged public comment as part of its own look at the question of floating houses. The council had a few members with concerns, but their official advice to TVA was this: no new floating houses should be allowed. All existing floating houses should be removed in 30 years or less, and TVA should implement and enforce regulations to this effect. So we have taken a long time and great care, I think, to consider all perspectives on this issue. And so our recommendation to the board today will be presented by Rebecca Tolene, our VP of Natural Resources. But let me tell you what we are going to put before the board. Recommending specific requirements for permitting existing floating houses so they meet safety and environmental standards. No new permits issued for floating houses. And a 30-year sunset provision. So I say I do appreciate all those who've taken the time to provide comments. I share many of the points of view. This has been a very tough issue, both for the board and for the staff. It has had the most input of anything in my time here. It has had the most political interest. And it's fair to say that some of that political input has been negative in intent. But this board and this organization have a duty of stewardship of public assets. And so let me go off my script here and just say what I heard this morning. What is being asked for is a permanent use of public property. And the words that were used this morning is, we want it in perpetuity and we want it in eternity. So the idea that these floating homes have a perpetual right to stay on assets owned by the public does not seem to me to be a particularly good stewardship resolution. Now, this is not a new idea from TVA. We actually have a land policy that addresses marinas, commercial recreation. And here's what it says. TVA leases or easements for commercial recreation purposes will contain restrictions against residential use, and no long-term accommodations or individually owned units will be permitted. The perpetual right exceeds the right of the marina owners, who have 30-year leases subject to 30-day notice cancellations. And I do want to assure the marina woman that her comments were all good. But that's a 30-year lease with a 30-day notice. We heard a lot about docks and piers. Those are revocable if you're out of contact, out of spec with 30 days notice. And so it's hard, at least for me, to say there is such a thing as a perpetual right to use public resources. This brings me to the question of enforcement. And it's very clear that enforcement by TVA of these standards has been lax. It has been uneven over the years. That's clear. And we need to do something about that. And I apologize for that. But it is also hard for me to grasp that lax enforcement creates a perpetual right. So, just the permanent exercise of private occupancy, use, or possession of public resources is not consistent with the stewardship mission of TVA. And so Rebecca will come and talk more about that, but at least now you know my views on this.
Aye.
TVA's policy on floating homes. I've asked Rebecca Tillene, TVA's Vice President of Natural Resources, to present this item. Rebecca?
Thank you, Director
Porter.
I appreciate that. I think I need it. Based on the listening session this morning and the comments we've received, we know this is a very difficult issue, particularly for marina owners and floating house owners. I'm going to echo our appreciation on behalf of TVA for the members of the public who either traveled here today to provide comments or have provided comments at numerous other forums that we've had with folks. Their professionalism and the points they made and the way they did that, have a lot of respect for that dialogue. I've even been invited to a couple front porches. I don't know if that's good or bad, but we definitely want to continue. You know, I'll mention, Bill mentioned it in his president's report, and the TVA board adopted a land policy in 2006, and that policy stated that it's TVA's policy to preserve reservoir lands in public ownership. And the policy went on to state that TVA would not allocate public land or land rights for residential use. And so today what we're doing is proposing steps to bring this thinking to the same reservoir land, just this land is inundated by water. We began a review of floating homes in April 2014. New structures have been prohibited since 1978. Transferring those permits, and that has been allowable since 1978, but no new structures have been permitted. We began to see a growing number of these just popping up on the reservoirs, and we started receiving marketing materials from developers who were seeking to build entire subdivisions on the water. These new structures were built without permits. Some would add a motor and a boat sticker on them and call them boats and say that they're outside of TVA's regulations. Yet these are very different structures. They're non-navigable, they're moored in one location. So out there, review our regulations and think about the future of our reservoirs. I think what we all have are beautiful and special places, and we only have to step outside, making sure all members of the public can enjoy this resource. Access ramps, fishing piers, public parks, campgrounds, trails. We know that the demands on this resource are only going to increase in the future. And so what we're trying to do is seek a balance between that public resource and a reasonable approach to regulation for the folks we heard from today.
Our purpose here today, we've spent a lot of time and effort trying to develop a policy that's fair. We've worked hard to have a transparent process. And today, we are going to be requesting the board adopt a policy that will help TVA better manage our reservoirs and benefit the public that we serve. The policy covers about four primary areas: a prohibition against new structures, standards to mitigate environmental and safety concerns, a fee structure so that the ratepayers would not be paying for the regulation of these privately owned structures, and some period of time when the structures will be removed from the reservoirs to allow others to enjoy the reservoirs in these spaces. Today, through our work with the External Relations Committee of the board and going through all of these comments, we're proposing an adjustment based on our input as part of our ongoing effort to balance the interests of those who have these structures and those that we serve that do not have these structures. I'll give you just a bit of background. I know you've heard a lot about this today. The top left smaller structure you see there is what we refer to as a non-navigable houseboat. These are typically smaller structures, although some have been rebuilt and made larger. These existed in some form 40 years ago in 1978. At that time, the TVA board said no more, but it gave after-the-fact revocable permits to the ones that were in place in 1978. The bottom picture on the left depicts a more modern floating house. Many of these structures are just what they look like, a residential house with all these residential amenities floating on the water. The picture to the right shows the path this issue was moving toward, full subdivisions on the lake, marinas more like subdivisions than recreation providers, and that was one of our concerns. So we actively engaged the public in this process. We reviewed various alternatives through our environmental review process, and again, we had numerous public meetings. We talked with marina associations, individual marina owners and floating homeowners, elected officials. As you heard today, we met with the Regional Resource Stewardship Council. We had an interagency team of federal and state agencies. And obviously, we talked with the general public, accepting comments via email, phone, and on our website. So the most prevalent issues raised and concerns are reflected in some of these photos: water quality and discharges from floating houses, electrical safety, mooring safety, and the private use of a public resource, one individual controlling a piece of the public reservoir. We also heard comments about TVA needs to share the blame and should not have allowed these floating homes, or should have been better at enforcing regulations about these floating homes. Floating homeowners, as you've heard this morning, desperately want them to remain, expressing concerns about individual financial impacts and economic development impacts to their communities. The non-floating homeowners who commented as part of our process generally supported removal, with a number of those supporting some kind of sunset period. Almost all the entities who commented and that I've spoken to do support revised rules and standards. So again, obviously, the most controversial of these provisions is the proposed sunset period after the 20 years. I have two sides. Many members of the public do not understand why we would grant these private structures an additional 20-year tenure. While the owners of these structures would like approval to remain on the reservoirs in these locations permanently. So our recommendation to you today: we did try to listen to folks, concerns over loans and being able to enjoy their investment, concerns about the economic impacts. After discussions with the committee, and I will say both to the committee and the individual board members, we appreciate the amount of time and energy and thought that you have all put into this issue. We are proposing a 30-year sunset period. This is a long time. But we believe this proposal goes even further to mitigate the impacts on owners and marina operators where they are located. To accept the idea that no sunset is appropriate and that these structure owners own a piece of the reservoir, that they can transfer in perpetuity, just isn't a place that seems like good stewardship. We also believe this is fair due to the fact that the longest term we have with a marina operator throughout the valley is 30 years, and that this time period will give folks time to enjoy their investments, personally or through rentals, and we believe it reflects the responsible economic useful life of these structures. So the policy we are asking you to adopt would prohibit new floating houses, clarify that all floating homes need a permit for TVA, and require existing floating homes to meet TVA standards. Todd, if you can flip, thank you. So these are some of the standards we've been working on, as you can see there. Ground fault circuit protection on the electrical, wastewater treatment rules, no expansion of structures, making sure we have the right insurance in place, and making sure when these are transferred that the TVA permit and prior written approval is required by TVA. We would be asking you to direct staff to develop standards along these lines and a cost recovery program for floating house structures and issue draft regulations. Those draft regulations would be available for public comment. You would be authorizing the amendments to the 26A regulations to implement this policy, and you would be directing staff to do an additional review of reasonable restraints on transferability and report to the board in 6 months. And that's really about us continuing this dialogue about options for the floating homeowners, and to try to figure out if there's any win-win in the situation. I'll say, you know, TVA had a similar issue on campgrounds, where individuals were using these public campsite resources as their private campground. With the support of the board and communities throughout the valley, we worked hard and implemented rules to ensure that these resources are available for all the public and don't become the domain of one person. We believe we need to continue that work in our reservoirs, but we also want to work with the communities we serve through new innovative ways to bring economic vitality and development to our reservoir communities, because they have something special and something that calls to visitors all over the world and to our local communities. We look forward to that work, and we look forward to continuing that dialogue to help our reservoir communities be successful. So, considering all the issues that we have heard relating to floating homes and the work we've done with the committee, we are today recommending the adoption of the floating house policy as presented to you in your books. Again, the primary means of implementing the policy would be through our regulations. We would issue draft regulations, and those would be available for public comment. Thank you for the opportunity to present today.
Thank you, Rebecca. You did an excellent job with that. The committee has reviewed this item now, and a majority of the committee has voted to recommend approval. I want to go on record here as being as respectful as I can to the committee members that and the committee that I chair, but I will plan to vote against this item. While I do agree with the policy's proposals to improve regulation of these structures, I do not believe a sunset period is warranted at this time. I believe that's something we could adopt later, but I would like to see us delay that kind of decision. I think the speakers that were here today have said everything that they could possibly say. I don't think I could add anything to their arguments, but I will am sympathetic to their position. TVA has spent some considerable time developing these proposals to address and the environmental and safety issues associated with the floating homes. However, as I said, I would just prefer to spend a little more time to see if we could find additional alternatives to adopting a sunset period. In any event, I understand the perspective of my fellow colleagues on the committee, and certainly we've just agreed to disagree and be respectful about it. So at this point in time, there is a motion, but there is a recommendation, but given my position, I don't think I should be the one to make a motion.
Thanks, Mike. Do we have a motion to approve the floating house policy behind tab 9 in your notebook?
So moved, Mr. Chair.
We have a second.
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 Okay, we are now in discussion. Before we begin this discussion, please understand the members of the audience that we have had a lot of disagreement on this subject. I want to make it absolutely clear. I do not believe in our role as management of the river. We have the right to give something that would last forever. I agree fully with Bill on that subject. I also think that we run into some legal issues that may prohibit that separately, even if we did on the river. But again, we just manage the river. So I'm going to open the floor for discussion. I'm going to encourage everyone to be respectful, because again, this is probably the most contested issue I have seen in my entire time on this board. But this board is very respectful of each other and understand sometimes we do disagree. So let's does anyone have any discussion items? Marilyn?
Well, I'd like to, again, of course, by echoing gratitude for everyone coming out and telling us their views on this issue. I have heard and learned a lot about the lax TVA enforcement and the possibly misleading communications about its land policy. Plus, I have a new appreciation from the information I heard this morning about the sizable economic hardship that a proposal might, a 30-year term might impose on homeowners, on marinas, and on communities. I feel I need more time to digest this information, and so I would like to propose that we table the vote on this motion until our next meeting.
I would second that, Mr. Chairman.
I want to make sure I have the procedure right. Sherry, would you please tell us what the appropriate procedure for motion to table till the next meeting?
According to Robert's Rules of Order, the proper motion would be a motion to postpone. For consideration at a time certain, which would be at the next meeting, as I understand your motion.
That's, okay. So that is the motion. Thank
the
you.
Motion is to postpone till the next meeting, which is the time certain. Do we have a second on that motion? Is that the correct? Excuse me a second.
Does the motion to postpone supersede the motion that's already on the floor?
Sure. There she is. Just, you might ought to stay there. I think this might.
I think the proper course is for, you've got a second on the motion to postpone, correct?
Yes.
Ask for discussion on that, then take a vote on that. Depending on the fate of that motion, you will either vote or not on the main motion.
All right. Okay, we do have a second on the motion. It is open for discussion. Again, please try not, let's one at a time. Does anybody have any comments?
Well, again, I would just say this. I would like to have more time to study about this. I think we've heard a tremendous amount of information today. While a lot of that I had gotten already in other letters and emails from people, they put a fresh light on some of the issues for me, and I would truly like to have a little while longer to digest all that I heard here, and frankly seek Rebecca's counsel as to are there any other alternative options before we take action. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is clear TVA has made a mess out of this for 40 years, and I'm not sure we can solve it today, and I'm not sure we can solve it in the August meeting, but it needs to be solved for everybody's sake, and apologize, we weren't on the board. Bill was not around, and I don't know exactly, Rebecca was not around in those days, so I know this has really created, our inactivity has created an economic monster for both TVA and for the people who are affected by it. So I would second that. And Marilyn, I appreciate you making that motion.
Pete?
I have a few comments I want to make. I want to start by saying that perpetual ownership of property on on public land, public property, I just cannot see how that is in any way permissible or possible. I was thinking, as listening to these discussions, I have a brother that's been out, who spent his adult life in the American West, much of which is owned by the public. And they fight over the use of public lands out there all the time. They've been doing it for 100 years. But they seem to do it much better than we do here. But TVA has created this monster, and I can support delaying a decision until the next board meeting, at which time we deal with it. Has TVA handled it well? Absolutely not. I will have to say that I really felt sorry for some of the speakers today, but there were others that I didn't, that if they didn't know better, they absolutely should have. Buying a piece of property on land on which you do not have a title opinion, that's not a good idea.
Any further comments?
Joe, I'd like to say one other thing, too. Ladies and gentlemen, I know there have been some pretty pointed comments directed towards Rebecca Tolene, and I can tell you from being on this committee and how she has handled herself and presented this item to us, she has gone out of her way to be as fair as she possibly can. So when she shows you some pictures of some abusive houses out there, let me assure you she has also shown us pictures of places that look like they probably belong more at Disney World, really, really well landscaped, really well maintained. And I think Rebecca has made every effort to be as fair about this as possible. So don't kill the messenger.
Yes.
That I can second.
Yes. Well, there's a motion on that part. But anyway, any other comments? I do have a few. There were many, many questions in my mind after listening to the speakers today. I don't have any idea who's right, who's wrong. I have gone into this thinking 30 years was a pretty good start. I heard a lot of speakers today that said things like, it hurts me today. No, it really doesn't hurt you today. And we are trying to solve a very complicated problem, and there are not going to be any great solutions. Nonetheless, the issues that were raised that I wrote down and would hope to get the answers from TVA, they're not possible to answer today, will lead me to where I believe that we should be delaying this to the August board meeting. So do we have any other further comments? We have a motion on the table to postpone until the August board meeting the motion that was made by the External Affairs Commission Committee. All in favor of the motion to delay, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's, how many, four? Raise your hand so I can see. All opposed?
All right.
Is that five? The motion fails. We now have the original motion to consider the matter that was presented by the External Affairs Committee back on the table. So that is back open for discussion. I believe that's the correct word. Rich, here you go. So we're now open discussion for that item. Is that correct? Okay, we're now discussing the item that was presented by the External Affairs Committee.
So, Joe, if I may.
Yes.
First, I want to thank everybody who came out and spoke to us. Clearly, a lot of emotion, a lot of passion, a lot of love for the respective communities that you have made your home, either permanently or in the summer. After listening to, I don't know, close to 40 speakers, I didn't think I was going to hear anything new. And then one gentleman who got up towards the end, who said everybody else said what he came to say, actually used the phrase right and fair. And that had not been used up until that point, but it's what I have written on my own piece of paper. And unfortunately, what's right and what's fair don't always line up exactly. You've heard mention of the land policy now several times. I also have that in front of me, and it's highlighted. I'm not going to reread it to you. What I think is right, and I say I because I don't know what's, if anyone wonders about sort of whether or not these votes are in any way, quote unquote, fixed, I can tell you right now, I have no idea what the outcome of this vote is going to be. And so when I'm speaking for me. What is right, in my view, is that we enforce the land policy. But what is also correct is that we have blundered over time such that folks face real potential investment loss. I think by providing for a 30-year sunset period, we buy ourselves time, all of us. And I believe the burden is on us, the TVA, to help mitigate any economic loss that may be suffered as a result of our inactions in the past and any actions we may take today. I feel strongly that the value of the decisions we make accrues to the public, to the many, not to the few. Another phrase we heard a couple times. And in my view, the problem with grandfathering the existing floating homes in perpetuity is that it creates just the opposite result. We were asked to use our hearts and not our heads in making this decision. I understand that request. I wish I could do that. But in the end, I feel that what is the right thing for us to do as stewards of this land is to enforce the policy that's on paper. And what is fair is to provide the necessary time needed to ensure we haven't brought economic devastation to those who have invested their retirement savings, in some cases, in this personal property. And I can only tell you that for me, as we look at this over the next 6 months, year, 2 years, we will explore every way possible to make sure we mitigate the economic hardship that this decision may or may not create. Thank you.
Are there any further comments?
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Lynn.
Yes, thank you. I too want to thank the floating house and marina owners who've taken time to speak during the public listening session today. You have put a face to the many comments, emails, letters, and phone calls we've all received related to this matter. Comments similar to those made today were taken into consideration by management and the External Relations Committee and to each of us as we've reviewed the information related to this matter. And we acknowledge that removal should not be enforced immediately because confusing information was evidently shared with some of you by TVA over the years. therefore giving 30 years additional time to enjoy the resources that you're taking advantage of now or you're enjoying now seems to be very reasonable and fair, in my opinion. As a board, when we think about the sunset provision, I think that we will probably consider to continue to agree to disagree on a sunset provision, and that's why I did not support a delay. I think that that's an item that 3 months from now we'll still be disagreeing on whether there should be a sunset provision or not. I think that as a board, our actions should support maintaining the public resources for public use, and I, for one, am going to support the recommendation that's being made out of the External Relations Committee. Thank you.
Do we have any other feet?
Yeah, I'm going to comment as well. I voted for the first delay the decision, but if the majority of the board feels like that they have sufficient information to make a decision, then I'm going to vote for the motion as presented.
Further comments?
I agree with Lynn and Eric's comments and feel as many of the floating home owners expressed today. You know, our laxness in the past is sort of what's created this problem. I feel like the sunset provision it's time that we took action to quit delaying that. And I agree with both Lynn and Eric that we do have time and we will continue to use time to find ways that there may be a model for us to move forward that is satisfactory to the homeowners and to TVA too. So it ain't over till it's over.
I think we're about to make it.
And just today, you know, our laxness in the past is sort of what's created this problem. I feel like the sunset provision it's time that we took action to quit delaying that. And I agree with both Lynn and Eric that we do have time and we will continue to use time to find ways that there may be a model for us to move forward that is satisfactory to the homeowners and to TVA too. So it ain't over till it's over.
Joe, can I make
one last comment? I appreciate everything that everybody has said on the board. Lynn, one thing you said that kind of triggered with me, I know we're going to agree to disagree on a sunset provision, and I want to echo what everybody said. Somewhere we have to craft some kind of solution that does not give perpetuity or eternity rights. Bill, I understand that. I'm just not satisfied yet that I've had enough time to thoroughly think this through, and that's why I would have rather gone to August before we took dramatic action here today. I totally agree with all the recommendations of the committee, except I'm just not comfortable with it as long as it has the sunset provision in it as it stands.
Do we have further discussion? I have a few points I would like to make. First is, as I said earlier, I don't think we have the right to do what was requested, and that's provide a permanent grandfathering clause, and I think we would run into many, many issues if we tried that again. That's not our river. We just manage it. We have had lengthy discussions that started off at 20 years due, but I also, if you noticed in there, there's a provision that our TVA staff is going to spend the next 6 months meeting with stakeholders, preparing regulations, and learning more and more about it. There's always that chance that something we miss so completely would lead to us reconsidering a particular matter. But right now, the motion on the table, and we have any further discussion, is as presented by Rebecca.
I have one more comment.
Yes, sir.
Before I attended my first TVA board meeting 3.5 years ago, somebody told me that board meetings are all cut and dried. Everybody knew in advance how they're going to go. We sure proved that to be a lie, haven't we?
Well, and one other comment Pete always made is, you know, if the board is always unanimous, then they only need one.
Well, I wish there were none on this issue. But we have the motion. We have a second. I think discussion is over. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Two. I think it passed on a 7-2. And we again appreciate all that took the time to be here. And we will continue to listen to this issue for, I believe, a long time to come.